Hello, my name is Georgie and I am the builder of the van project known as Building Bluebell. I'm currently sat inside the cab doing this introduction because the weather is so beautiful and sunny outside that I couldn't see. So this video is going to cover, for the most part, the roof and the ceiling of Bluebell, which was a really big project. I'll be taking you through some of the design features, some of the dilemmas and problems I had within the building and construction process, and we'll also be taking a look at some technical crayon drawings which I have done to try and sort of accompany my ramblings and give it some context, especially of the internal framework, which you can't see anymore. Something probably to note at the beginning is that some of my terminology through the video may be a little bit inaccurate because I'm self-taught, so that will probably reflect in some mishaps of the vocabulary. And last but not least, I will be the real-time version of me in the live event will be trying to answer your questions in the comments. So during this video, if you have any questions, please pop them in the comments and I'll do my best to respond to them well. So without much further ado, let's go look at the van. I've been sat in my little porch for a little while outside here, trying to figure out how I even start this video and where to begin with the roof, because it wasn't just a creative process, but it was a massively emotional one. Within the one roof, there's sort of multiple projects that each have their own talking points and their own sources of inspiration and their own backstory. Just trying to grasp how I start this has been a bit difficult. Okay, I need to stop rambling and start saying something meaningful. I think I need to start at the seed of the inspiration, which was when I was living in New Zealand and I was seeing the iconic house trucks out there and was totally blown away by the absolute ludicrousy, marvellous ludicrousy, that something like that could be on a motor. And from there I started getting all my own very abstract thoughts and really pushing the boundaries in my mind with something that I could make if I somehow acquired the skills and the money. And it started there, this little seed, and it grew sort of quite aggressively, very quickly. It took over all of my thought processes. I stopped spending any money and saving everything I was earning. And started coming up with these concepts. When I would tell people, they'd tell me I was bonkers and nuts, and quite rightly so, in the respect that it was such an abstract thought, and I didn't have anything to show for it. So one of the first things I did was I made this small clay structure. And it's turned out actually quite similar to the main roof. There's the porch there at the front, and then there's the two eyebrow windows either side. And it's pretty funky seeing that, and seeing that it stayed to this original abstract thought I had. I think from the moment of seeing those house trucks, I knew I had to do something really different, which is definitely why the roof looks different. If we come over here, I can sort of give maybe a slight comparison. There is definite similarities there. It's a bit windy. Let's go back to the safety of the porch. Ooh, blimey. Something really important I feel to mention is that the entire structure of the roof, the shape, the process, the design, and most importantly the initial inspiration, got wilder and wilder with every comment I received that suggested I couldn't build this alone as a woman. And believe it or not, I actually got a lot of that at the beginning of the project. and in my own infuriated response to this, it was very emotional and impulsive, but my own response to this was to make a point, to make a really big metal, shiny aluminium point. And I'm happy about it, although at the beginning those attitudes and comments and some of the conversations I had were really upsetting and disappointing. It inspired me a great amount to prove it wrong, and it also pushed me in that respect to learn a lot about myself. I think that's a big backstory behind the roof. I've been going through some of my old notebooks and sketchbooks from the construction stage of the project, trying to find any visual drawings or references to how I thought I might build the framework at the time. And there aren't any, because during this whole process of building Bluebell, and especially the roof, there were absolutely no plans or sort of logical sketches. They're all sort of manic doodles and cartoon drawings and like shaded blocks of pencil with like forms in them, which made up the entire planning process of the van. And it's been a bit of a trip down memory lane doing this video, because it reminds me that when I started building the roof, I had an idea of what shapes I wanted and what materials I would use, because I had to accumulate those, as it was all made from offcuts. But other than that, I just went outside and started building it, and every single decision or plan was made in the moment, which is why it turned out so sort of playful and organic, I think. So I'm going to show you some of those drawings, because I think it gives a good insight into the roof and the process behind it. Well, I haven't introduced Fiver, so this is a good stage to do it, even though she drastically upstaged me. Come here! Come on! Come here! Come here! Oh, God. This page here was actually the closest thing I could find to an idea of how I would make my curved formers in the roof. Most of the other drawings are all much more like this, which are quite childlike and cartoonish. And a common theme through all of my planning stages or drawing was pretty childlike. It's just about finding that sensation of the shape you're doing. I've just found one of the original doodles from the beginning of the project about 3 years ago, and it's pretty similar to what I have going on now. It's stayed very much in line with this original image, with the curves and that shape of the roof. And it's nice to see, because I think it's really important to stay in touch with your inner child when you build and design and create, and to not stifle and suppress it under the fear and pressure of convention, which can be really overwhelming. It's definitely something I've always kept in my mind when building Bluebell, to try and notice when I'm suffocating that inner kid. But what I've done is I've made some more accurate drawings of the internal framework to show you now, which will hopefully give you an idea of what's going on underneath that cladding. The way that I formed the shape in Bluebell's roof was by having ply formers. I found a pattern that I liked and used that to keep a uniformed shape going throughout the build. But for the most part, each one of these here, which forms sort of the skeleton of the roof, was actually made up of small pieces of ply and connected together with screws and wood glue. So it was like a massive jigsaw puzzle, basically. The element of the roof framework that takes the fixings for the external and internal cladding and also provides most of the structural strength is these 2x1 timber beams here, which I notched into the ply work. The barrel-shaped roof is interrupted in three places. There are two eyebrow windows, and there's this front facing here which goes down onto the branch-rimmed porch. Something I had a lot of fun making was this branch overhang. It was kind of hilarious putting it up there because I've built it alone, actually lumbering up this piece of oak and balancing it and trying to get the cuts right was a massive challenge, and I swore a lot, but it was really fun. And making the aluminium come down onto the top of this branch was difficult, but I think it gave the sort of shape of the roof a really unique little twist. I've come in here to talk about the external cladding materials. When I was building the framework for the roof, I didn't have any idea what I would be cladding it with. So I was building it a bit blind in that respect. So once I'd finished the woodwork, I went on a massive material hunt. I searched long and far in big sort of scrap yards, looked online at Gumtree. But then eventually my aunt found a tiny little scrapyard in a village nearby, and we went there and we found these amazing little sheets of aluminium, which were from a garden centre and were used for the seedlings, potting the seedlings. And they were old and dirty and smelly and oxidised, which meant I couldn't heat them. But for me, they were perfect, and most importantly, they would be recycled. So I bought every single sheet that he had at £5 a sheet. I bought 50, so, oh no, I think that's £250. I could be totally wrong on that, don't hold me to it. The spooky thing was is that every single sheet I used, so if I'd had a single wastage or mistake, he didn't have any more, so that was one of those wonderfully spooky coincidences. The actual process and time it took to make the roof was about 6 months on and off. I built it with just a pair of tin snips and hammer, that was it. And it was hands down the most brutal thing I have ever done to myself in my life, ever. It was through the worst of winter, and I'm building the van up here on a really cold exposed hill, and I don't really know how I got through some of those days of moulding these sheets. It would take all of my force to mould them down, and the worst part was the sheets that required to bend in more than one direction, which there are quite a few of. I had quite an emotional journey with it. I adopted Fiver, my dog, at that time because I was getting so sad. So I actually find it quite hard to talk about the roof because it was just a crazy experience. But, you know, inevitably it got me what I needed, which is a waterproof, lightweight and, you know, aesthetically pleasing roof. And I would never go back in time and tell myself not to do it. I'm just never going to do it again. It gets me in a bit of a tizzle talking about it. But I'll show you some videos now of the external side of it, and we'll get off me rambling. The eyebrow windows actually extend a fair amount from the main roof here, but all without actually extending past the width. It's just sort of working off of this curve here. I also very recently polished this aluminium, and
there was a strategic decision when I was putting on the sheets not to clean them up first and mold them with the hammer before touching the surface. So when I polished them, all of the individual hammer marks have shown up.
Naturally, one of the main worries I had with a moving vehicle that is also your house is that the water from the rain would drive up underneath the aluminium sheeting. So the way I combated this was I went to the scrapyard and I got this old copper boiler tank and I cut it into strips and I made a sort of flashing system. It rises up underneath the aluminium by about 10 centimeters and there's a layer of liquid rubber that connects them and seals that together. It also prevents any corrosion from the copper on the aluminium when water is introduced. Underneath every overlap there is a nice big blob of waterproof sealant. I think it's called CT1 and it's horrible stuff to apply, but you can really tell that it does the job. And these are the fixings that I used, and if I remember correctly, I think they're called hex nut screws, and they come with these washers that as you tighten it down, they sort of squidge out and create this waterproof barrier. And they're really inexpensive for what they do, and I just think they're brilliant, and they create a really strong fixing. Something I've just reminded myself of is a what seems like a theme in comments and skepticism people have about the roof, which is that it's not strong enough to hold my body weight, or it's not strong enough to hold anything particularly load bearing because of the thin nature of the wood I used. So I decided it's time to prove a little point, hold my imaginary beer.
Purple hat, cheetah print, dancing on the people, rolled up at the after joint, dancing on the people, people dancing on the people. I got people on the people, people dancing on the people, with the people on the people, smoking CO2, see me, see you dancing on the people, climb up on the booth, hanging from the people, on the people, my head is the roof, dancing on the ceiling, on the people. I got people on the people, dancing on the people. I got purple hat, cheetah print, dancing on the people, rolled up at the after joint, dancing on the people.
The entire internal cladding of the roof is made from cedar. It was all offcuts and waste material from other projects, and I sort of did an experiment because I love Waney Edge, that's what I've used on the outside of the van, and I'd never seen a picture of anyone using it on the interior, so I decided to give it a go, and I feel like it worked out really well. It gives you the sensation of being inside a mushroom and the colours are really warm. It was less challenging than I thought actually to put up because the boards are quite thin, they had a bit of flex. It's really hard in photographs to try and give people an idea of the size of the van. In some photos it looks massive and then in other pictures it looks quite small. So I wanted to give you a bit of perspective. I'm 5'9". And if I reach up to the top, I can't actually touch the top of the roof. So it is a really barreled shape so that you get this really strong sense of headspace. I can just about do it if I reach on tiptoes. It was a bit of a struggle with connecting it to the eyebrow windows here because of the curve in the formers. I did get some splits and cracks, but generally this part actually went on quite easy. It was one of the easier parts of the build. With the dome, that was also done in cedar. So I actually took these planks and I cut them down into small strips to try and give me more flexibility because the dome is just curves all over the place. And every single plank has a directional cut into it. So gradually the shape of the cladding changes, and that was a massive project. It took me 3 months to clad the dome. This again was went with the ethos of the project that it was off cut and waste, and it's ended up giving it a really organic feel as well, so I'm quite pleased with how that's turned out. So I wanted to come up here also to give you a feeling of perspective in the dome. There's more headspace in here and more feeling of space than I actually imagined it would be when I built it. Because there are so many arches going on, your head has so much sort of space to play around with and get lost in. I was just able to gently work with the wood and listen to it. And if I started hearing any cracks, I would stop and I would just come back to it the next day. And gently, I sort of shaped the wood. It was like a partnership. There was no forcing going on because it would just crack. And I would have lost all the work I did getting the cut and the sort of shape of the wood. So there was definitely a two-way situation going on with this woodwork. And that's really a testament as well to the cedar being so giving in many ways. The dome was a happy accident. So I knew that I couldn't have the Luton style conversion of the cab going above and sort of continuing at the same height from the main roof because I knew I'd get claustrophobic in there. I need to be able to sit up in bed and have that headspace. So I started making some doodles and coming up with a shape that I would like, and really just tapped into my child brain and had a lot of fun just making shapes with pieces of wood, which is basically the whole build process of this van. There were a lot of challenges, like for example with this four-way join up here, of how to join it, how to connect it. I just had no idea. And it was one of those moments where I woke up first thing in the morning with rare clarity and just grabbed my pen and my notebook, found a fresh page, and I had just had the answer, which I find really interesting because I think that's it's really a part of our natural subconscious to be working out problems. And I think that inner engineer lives in every single one of us, and tapping into it and enjoying its presence, I guess, has been the most rewarding part of building this van, I think. So I think that's everything covered, or at least everything I can cover with the time frame that I have. So thank you for watching. Thank you to Quirky Campers for giving me the opportunity to do this. It's been really fun, if not a tiny bit out of my comfort zone. So sorry if I've rambled at all or been nonsensical. If you'd like to see any more pictures of the van or follow the update further, then I have a Instagram called Building Bluebell. So thank you for watching. Stay safe, everybody. Bye-bye.